second of your loudest voices, with your loudest voices, a voice which is Shi'i, a voice which is Haydari, a voice which is Alawi, a salawat that will reach the Malaika in Najaf al-Ashraf, salawat ala Muhammadin wa ali Muhammad. Allahumma salli ala Muhammadin wa ali Muhammad. Mu'ajjil faraja. Allah yubarik fikum. There is a request from the back, brothers and sisters. Bila zahma, if you are able to come little bit forward, you make way for your brothers and sisters who are coming in later on. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. We are gathered here tonight to commemorate the birth anniversary of a person whom the human mind is not able to understand in his entirety. Where do you begin this khutbah? Where do you begin this lecture? Where do you begin this introduction from? When you attempt to describe a person whose reality cannot be comprehended by the human mind. And this is a reality to which Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, this is a reality which the Holy Prophet points towards, where once he looks at Amir al-Mu'mineen and he says to him, Ya Ali, la ya'rifuka illallah wa ana. He says, Ya Ali, nobody understands you, nobody recognizes you except Allah and except myself. Only the creator of Ali can recognize Ali. Only that Nabi, Khatamil Anbiya, from whose nur, the nur of Ali is created, only that person can understand Ali. Outside Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and outside Khatamil Anbiya, there is not a single person within the realm of wujud that can understand Amirul Mu'mineen. Rasulullah makes this absolutely clear. This is a personality, subhanallah. The more you try to understand him by reading through his seerah, the more baffled and the more perplexed the mind gets. Yet the more you read about him, your love for this person begins to increase. And then you see over here that the intellect is put in a situation that cannot be described by words. Because on one hand, the more you study about this person, the more perplexed you become. And on the other hand, the more you study about this person, the more you fall in love with him. So you come across a situation between this burning rage of unrestlessness, where the mind is not at ease because it is perplexed, and at the same time, the same mind, despite being confused, is intoxicated with the love of Ali ibn Abi Talib. Between these, between this burning rage of love and confusion, you see that the mind senses a soothing coolness. This soothing coolness, ahibba'i, is known as iman. Because Rasulullah says, Ya Ali, hubbuka imanun wa bukdhuka kufur. When you are perplexed and you are astounded, you don't know who this Amirul Mu'mineen is, you don't know who this person is, yet you are helplessly in love with him. And there is something that draws you towards this everlasting confusion. Know that this is iman that is taking you towards Ali. Every step of his life, every stage of his life is one that perplexes the human mind, starting from the very incident of the birth of Amirul Mu'mineen. And when we say the birth of Amirul Mu'mineen, it is not that he came into existence, he came into wujud, and that before that he was Adam. La. This is a movement or a change in the phase of the existence when you say Mawlud of Amir al-Mu'mineen. This is when that Noor, which was put by the right side of the Arsh, now comes in the form of a human body in the dunya. This Noor that was a source of guidance for the Alam al-Ghayb, this Noor which was a guide of, which was a source of guidance for the Malaika, has now come back, or has now come down to the earth to be a source of guidance for mankind. Ajib. Shaykhana, how is Amir al-Mu'mineen a source of guidance for the Malaika and for those in the realm of the Malakut? There is a tradition which is mentioned within our books, a tradition that has reached the level of Istifada, Mustafa it is. The narration states, once Amir al-Mu'mineen and Rasulullah are sitting in Masjid al-Nabawi, and there is a person who comes towards Rasulullah and Amir, and he shows him respect in the highest manner of respect. Yani, literally respect to the dot. Rasulullah sitting amongst all the companions, he asked this person, why is it that you go out of your way to show respect for this young person, Amir al-Mu'mineen, perhaps in his early 20s or in his youth? This person looks at Rasulullah. He says to him that I am Jibra'il that has come to you in the form of a human being. Rasulullah says, what is the reason for your respect, utmost respect for Amir al-Mu'mineen? He says, I'm giving him the respect that a student must give to a teacher. Ajib. Rasulullah says, Ali ibn Abi Talib is your teacher. Jibra'il says, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created me, I was placed in front of the arsh, and then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asked me, man ana wa man ant. He says, Allah asked me, who am I and who are you? I was astounded by the noor of the arsh of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I didn't know what to answer Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I heard a voice from behind me say, Kul anta rabbul jaleel wa ana abduka dhaleel. I repeated, anta ya Allah rabbul jaleel wa ana abduka dhaleel. You are the mighty grand Lord, and I am nothing but a despicable servant. Jibra'il says, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loved my answer so much that he made me in charge of delivering the wahi to every prophet from Adam to Khatam. I turn around to see who is this person who has given me the answer. I turn around, I see Ali ibn Abi Talib salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi. Transfer of Noor from the Malakut to the Dunya. This is the reality of the Mawlud of Amir al-Mu'mineen. Tradition by our sixth Imam al-Sadiq, salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi. This can be found in Biharul Anwar, the edition that we have, volume 35. Tradition by the sixth Imam, he describes the birth of Amir al-Mu'mineen. He says that Abbas ibn Abdul Muttalib and Yazid ibn Ka'nab were sitting by the Kaaba in the days of Jahiliyyah. This is 10 or 12 years, according to some traditions, before the proclamation, open proclamation of Risala by the Holy Prophet. He says, we were sitting by the Kaaba and we saw Fatima bint Asad come in towards the mosque. At that time, it was not a mosque per se that we have right now. Market, houses, streets, and in the middle of all this, in the vicinity, is the Kaaba. For Abbas ibn Muttalib and Yazid ibn Ka'nab, both of them are narrating this incident. They say that we saw Fatima bint Asad come towards the Kaaba. She stood in front of the Kaaba, and then she was in the later, in the last stages of her pregnancy. 9 months in that she was awaiting to give birth to Amir al-Mu'mineen. In this state of late pregnancy, she looks, she faces towards the Kaaba, and then she raises up her hands and she makes a dua. She speaks with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. She says, Ya Ilahi, إني مؤمنة بك وبكل ما جاء به من عندك الرسل. She says, يا الله, I am a believer in you and I am a believer in every prophet that you have sent. وأنا مؤمنة بكل كتاب أنزلته, and I am a believer in every book that you have revealed. وأنا مؤمنة بكلام جد إبراهيم الخليل الذي بنى هذا البيت العتيق, and I am a believer in the message of my grandfather Ibrahim al-Khalil, who built this house. During the time of Jahiliyyah, there was this pure lineage of people who still believed in the unity and the tawheed of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. From here we understand that Fatima bint Asad is also from the lineage of Nabi Ibrahim. She was a believer in the oneness of the message of Ibrahim. She was one of those people from one of those families whose najasa of shirk and kufr has never touched this lineage. And then she raises her hands towards Allah. She says, Ya Allah, or she says, Ilahi, inni as'aluka bihaqqi hadhal bayt wa bihaqqi man banaha wa bihaqqi المولود الذي في إحشائي. She says, Ya Allah, I ask you by the sake of this house, and I ask you by the sake of the person who built this house, and I ask you by the sake of this baby who is in my womb. لما يسرت علي ولادتي. She says, I pray to you and I beseech you by these three. Wasila is something that existed and is from the sunnah of Nabi Ibrahim. Those people and those voices that come out and are against the wasaila, they should know that they are not only against the deen of Rasulullah, but they are against the deen of Nabi Ibrahim al-Khalil, who built the Kaaba. Allahu Akbar. Abbas ibn Abdul Muttalib and Yazid ibn Ka'anab say, as soon as she said this, he says, فَإِذَا هِيَ دَعَتْ بِهَذَا الدُّعَى فرعين البيت كان انفتح من ظهره. Allahu Akbar. As soon as she performed this dua, Abbas says that we looked at the house and the corner of the bayt, yani the Kaaba, the corner of the bayt, kad infataha laha, it split open for her. Fatima bint Asad walked inside. Abbas said, Abdul Muttalib says, faghabat anna, she faghabat an absarina, she disappeared into the darkness of the Kaaba. We stood up, and as soon as she entered, فعادت الفتحة وإلتزكت البيت بإذن الله تعالى. We stood, we were tried to look into where she has gone. We approached the crack towards the Kaaba. Abbas says that as soon as she entered the Kaaba, just like the way it miraculously opened, it miraculously closed back in that part. Abbas and Yazid say that we went forward towards the door of the Kaaba. We tried to open the door with a key, but the lock will not open. We tried to bring other people from the family of Abdul Muttalib who might be able to open the lock. One other tradition says outside the one of Bihar that they tried to break the lock with a stone, but the lock on the door of the Kaaba would not open. Abbas says, فَعَلَمْنَا أَنَّ هَذَا مِنْ أَمْرِ اللَّهِ. Abbas says, we knew that this was one of those actions from a divine Lord and a divine power. Allahu Akbar. The narration says that the entire Makkah was speaking about this event. How is it that a woman who is pregnant, carrying a baby in her womb, how is it that she comes into the Kaaba and the wall miraculously opens for her and closes back? How is it that the door of the Kaaba cannot open and this lock cannot be opened? This incident became the conversation of each and every family in Makkah. You go into the markets, the traders are speaking about how the walls of the Kaaba split open for Fatima bint Asad. You look at the children are talking what they heard in the house, and the talk in the house is how the Kaaba split open for Fatima bint Asad. For 3 days, the narration says, the people of Makkah surrounded the Kaaba, waiting to see what would happen, waiting to see when Fatima bint Asad would come out, waiting to see how she will come out. Allahu Akbar. the tradition says that on the third day, the same point of the Kaaba where Fatima bint Asad entered, she came back on that fourth day, the Kaaba from the same corner split open. Fatima bint Asad comes out, wa ala yadayha Ali. She says she comes out of the Kaaba. She comes out of the Kaaba and she has a newborn baby in her hand. Allah, the people are looking at her. They are looking. They don't know whether to be mesmerized by which miracle. Should they be mesmerized by the nur that is shining from this newborn infant? A nur that glows from his face and rises up to the heavens. Should you be mesmerized by this? Or should you be mesmerized by the fact that the Kaaba has split open in front of you again and has split back in front of you again as enjoined back together? The people are stunned, the people are astounded, and at this point Fatima bint Asad alayha salam stands. She is standing, she is holding Amir al-Mu'mineen. She says, Ayyuhannas. She is now addressing the people who are absolutely dumbfounded and don't know what to make of this situation. She says to them, Ayyuhannas. قَدْ أَخْتَارَنِ اللَّهُ وَفَدَّلَنِي عَلَىٰ كُلُّ مِنْ قَبْلِي مِنْ نِسَاءِ الْعَالَمِينَ. She says, Fatima bint Asad says, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has honored me and has selected me over every other woman from the women of the world who have come before me. Then she goes on to give the reason for this. She says, I gave birth in the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَبَكَيْتُ فِيهِ ثَلَاثَةَ أَيَّامِ أَعْكُلْ مِنْ تِمَارِ الْجَنَّةِ وَأَوْرَاكِهَا. She says that I was the guest of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala inside the Kaaba. I gave birth inside the house of Allah. I was his guest for 3 days and I ate from the fruits of Jannah for the 3 days that I was inside the Kaaba. Even more stunning than this, she says, and when I wanted to come out with my baby, فَإِذَا حَتَفَ بِي حَاتِفٌ. She says that I heard a cry from the skies, or a person cried out. You can't say person. Best way to translate this is to say that she heard a cry from the heavens. Ajib. Who is this cry from? Is this the cry of Jibrail? Is this the cry of Mikael? Is this the cry of Israfil? Who is it? You find out from the content of the message over here. She says, فَإِذَا حَتَفَ بِي حَاتِفٌ وَقَالَ لِي يَا فَاتِمَا سَمِّيهِ عَلِيًّا فَإِنِّي كَدْ اشْتَكَكْتُ or فَإِنِّي كَدْ اشْتَكْتُ إِسْمُهُ مِنْ ismi fa ana aliyun a'la. The speaker is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He says, oh Fatima, name this child Ali, because I have derived his name from my name and I am aliyul a'la. Allahu akbar.
Ali, Ali.
Ali,
हम सब का रहबर, हम सब का शाफी, सहरा का शोहर, हसनैन का बाबा, काबे का काबा, मौलूदे काबा, मूसा से पूछा, ईसा भी बोले, आसमान पुकारा, जमीन भी बोली, वादा है खैबर, साखी है कौसर, शाफी है महशर, मौला है कंबर, आका है अबू
Ali,
Lakko to Sahara,
Ali,
Lubo to Kinara,
Ali,
Nabiyon Pukara,
Ali, Ali,
Aliyan Katara,
Ali, Ali,
Aliyon ki chahak mein,
Ali, Ali,
Ulon ki mehak mein,
Ali, Ali,
Sachi baat mein,
Ali, Ali,
Hijrat ki raat mein,
Ali, Ali,
Namaz salat mein,
Ali, Ali,
Zor se bolo,
Ali, Ali,
Mil ke bolo,
Ali, Ali,
Jhoom ke bolo,
Ali, Ali, Haydari, Ya Ali, Ahsant.
Kad ishtaktu ismu min ismi, I have derived his name from my name, Allahu Akbar. Based on this name, The names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Asma'ul Husna. From the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Ismul A'zam. Allahu Akbar, Muhibbi, Amirul Mu'mineen. Listen, there is a tradition which is narrated in the book Ma'ad or Madinatul Ma'ajiz, that one time Amirul Mu'mineen, while he is in his youth, is walking through the streets or is walking from Medina, was passing towards or was walking through the outskirts of Medina, and he passed through a person who was a Khaybari, a Yahud who was living at the time or in the place of Khaybar. This is before Fathul Khaybar by far. This Khaybari, he looks at Amir al-Mu'mineen as they are in the outskirts and they are passing through a place where there is a river in the outskirts of Medina. This person, or the tradition says that this person looked at Amir al-Mu'mineen and then he removed his rida, he removed his cloak, he placed it over the water, and suddenly he decided that he will walk on top of the water, on top of his abba. Yani he placed the abba on top of the water and he stood on top of the water without his feet going in. Ajib, this Khaybari, this Jewish person looks at Amir al-Mu'mineen. Taban, perhaps he doesn't know who is Amir al-Mu'mineen. He says to him, Ya Hada, he says, oh person, if you knew what I knew, then you would be able to do what I can do, stand on the water. Ajib, Amir al-Mu'mineen looks at him and he says, is that so? He comes towards this person, stands at the brink of the river on which this person is standing miraculously. Amir al-Mu'mineen asks him, and how is it that you are able to stand on this place like this? In other words, how is it that you are able to perform this miracle? This Khaybari looks at Amirul Mu'mineen, and perhaps this is not within the tradition, but if you try to imagine this situation within your mind, it's as if this Khaybari has pride. He puts up his chin and he looks down at Amirul Mu'mineen and he says, Da'autullah bi ismihil a'zam, Allahu Akbar. He says that I asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through the ismul a'zam, and he allows me to perform this feat. Amirul Mu'mineen looks at him and he says, and do you know what the ismul a'zam is? He says, yes. Amir al-Mu'mineen says, tell me, what is the ismul a'zam? This person says, Sa'altullah bi ismi wasiyyi Muhammad, Allahu Akbar. He says that I asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through the ismul a'zam. What is the ismul a'zam? The wasi of Rasulullah. Amir al-Mu'mineen looks at him, he points towards the water, the entire water freezes. Amir al-Mu'mineen stands on that frozen water. The person asks him, oh man, how were you able to do this? Amir al-Mu'mineen says, that ismul a'zam through which you do dua, I am that ismul a'zam.
Ya Ali,
fad'ullah li asma'ihi al-husna. Seek or pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through the Asma'il Husna. Imam As-Sadiq alayhi salam says, Nahnu wa Allah subhanahu. Sixth Imam says, Nahnu wa Allah al-Asma'il Husna. He says, we are by Allah that Asma'il Husna. It is through us that the du'as are mustajab. It is through our love and our obedience that the a'mal of the entire creation is accepted. Allahu Akbar. Ajib that people come forward and put ishkal on the fada'il of Ahlul Bayt. Even on fada'il like this, you go back to the books of the history, go back to the tafaseer. If a person was to look at this hadith where Ahlul Bayt, Imam As-Sadiq is saying, Nahnu wallah asma'il husna, this is the most logical statement that an imam or that a person can make when you compare the level of Ahlul Bayt and understand the level of Ahlul Bayt as per the Quran and as per the books of Aqaid and Kalam, which the Mufassirina, the scholars of the Imamiyah have written. Where is the ishkal in this? Rasulullah goes forward and says, Subhanallah, if you think that fada'il and merits like these are beyond and that the level of Ahlul Bayt has been raised more than we should, then such a person is mistaken and mistaken and for a third time mistaken, because the fada'il that we have today of Amirul Mu'mineen and Ahlul Bayt are not but a drop of an ocean. Rasulullah himself has held back intentionally a number of the fada'il of Ahlul Bayt and in particular Amirul Mu'mineen. Why? Rasulullah himself says, had I not been scared that my ummah will do to Ali like the way the Christians did to Isa, I would have given you fada'il and secrets of Ali ibn Abi Talib. You would take barakah from the dust under the feet of Ali ibn Abi Talib. Salawatullahi wa salamuhu alayhi. بعد these merits and these fada'il, truthfully speaking, they can't even be considered fada'il in the way of Amir al-Mu'mineen. Can't be considered fada'il. Amir al-Mu'mineen split the moon, fada'il. Amir al-Mu'mineen from the Asma al-Husna, fada'il. Amir al-Mu'mineen was able to raise the dead bi-idhnillah ta'ala, lest anybody says shirk, fada'il. No. Shi'adi. This is something normal. It is amazing for us because our minds are so limited. When we see an action like this, we say, subhanallah, it's great. But for Amir al-Mu'mineen, the way that he is, these are things that should not baffle anyone. When you look at the fada'il of Amir al-Mu'mineen, or what we perceive to be a fada'il, don't ever mistake yourself and feel pride that you have understood Amir al-Mu'mineen. We have not understood Amir al-Mu'mineen. But there is no other way to describe the greatness of this person except through actions like this. In Tumsawwaru, you want to describe somebody who's a marja taqlid. How do you explain the status of a marja taqlid to somebody who's not anywhere in the religion, nothing to do with deen, nothing to do with religion, nothing whatsoever? How do you explain to him who is a marja taqlid and the value of a marja taqlid? You would go to him, you tell him that this person is a marja taqlid, he's very great. He'll ask you why? Because he's memorized Suratul Ikhlas. With all due respect and all the importance and the shan and the adama of Suratul Ikhlas. But if you tell somebody that Fulan is a marja taqlid because he's memorized Suratul Ikhlas, what will you do? You laugh and say, Shi'adi, what do you mean? This is a fadila for him? La! Same way when it comes to Amir al-Mu'mineen, whether it is Shakul Kamar or Shakul Bahar, whether he was there to remove Nabi Ibrahim from the fire of Namrud, or whether it was through his name that Musa was able to separate the oceans, this is something normal because Ali is created from the nur of Nabi and Rasulullah is created from the nur of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What is this nur? We cannot understand, which is why we are majboor to understand Amir al-Mu'mineen through the fada'il. Otherwise, the fada'il do not captivate the essence and the reality of Amir al-Mu'mineen. Is much greater than to be perceived. If we understand this, then do you not laugh at the person who comes and tells you, Allah, this is ghulu? Awalan, what is the definition of ghulu? Ajib. We go back to our talk. Fatima bint Asad says, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told me, or Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded me, what we understand. Sammihi aliyan, faqad in shakaktu ismahu or ismuhu min ismi, wa ana aliyul a'la. At this point, the tradition says, Abu Talib came, though time is always racing against us. Abu Talib came, alayhi salam, extremely happy. The tradition says that when Abu Talib took Amir al-Mu'mineen in his hands, Amir al-Mu'mineen said to him, As-salamu alayka ya Aba. An infant who is just newly born. He says to him, As-salamu alayka ya Aba. He says, peace be upon you, O my father. Abu Talib returns back the salam. The tradition says that Jibreel descended upon Rasulullah and he informed him that his wazir and his wasi has now come to the dunya. Rasulullah leaves from the house that he was in Makkah and he rushes towards the house of Abu Talib. At that point, he sees Fatima bint Asad holding this infant. The noor is glowing from his face through the roof of the house into the heavens. The tradition says says that the baby, Amir al-Mu'mineen, turned his face towards Rasulullah and he smiles. Why? This is a nur that was once together by the arsh of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala before Adam was created. And now they are together in the dunya. The tradition says Rasulullah took Amir al-Mu'mineen in his arms. Amir al-Mu'mineen says, As-salamu alayka ya Rasulullah. Rasulullah says, wa alayka as-salam. The tradition goes on to say that Amir al-Mu'mineen then said, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, Kad aflahal mu'minun. Allahu Akbar. He says until the end of the ayah, he says, Kad aflahal mu'minun. He says, indeed, the believers, the mu'mineen are victorious. Kad aflahal mu'minun. The believers or the mu'mineen are victorious. Rasulullah looks at him and he says, Aflahu bika ya Ali. If the mu'mineen are successful, then they have become successful through you, ya Ali. How can we substitute our master for somebody else when you have a master like Ali ibn Abi Talib? Kad aflaha al-mu'minun. Every person who holds love for Amir al-Mu'mineen in his heart, whether he's a believer or he's a sinner, and we are not in a place where we want to justify sinning, la, but what we are saying is a reality. Every one of you can attest for this inside your heart. A person, whether he's a true believer, sincere, follows the deen to the dot, or a person who has shortcomings, and the person who is a sinner, regardless of which category you are, by the sake or by virtue of the love that you hold for Amir al-Mu'mineen in your heart, you hope that you will drink from the cup of Kawthar. Allahu Akbar. This is the mu'min. From the time that he is born, from the time that he is raised in his family, he is taught nothing but to say Ya Ali. When he wants to get a tarbiyah, when he wants to catch a certain manhaj, when he wants to build and mold his personality, he goes back to Nahjul Balaga and he looks for the poet Ya Ali. This is a mu'min. Every step of his life, he is never separated from Imam Ali. This is a mu'min that when he wants to become victorious or wants to gain victory in the akhirah, even at the time of death, when the soul is reaching here, he will say Ya Ali. A mu'min is that person when he is raised into the grave and Munkar and Nakir will come to question him, he will say Ya Ali. A mu'min is that person when he is raised from the mahshar and the mountains are crumbling and he is wearing his kafan, he will say Ya Ali. A mu'min is that person when he realizes that his sins have overcome him and there is only one person can save him from the trials and tribulations of Jahannam. That person is Ya Ali. There is only one person under whose flag you can enter into Jannah, and that person is Ali ibn Abi Talib. Love for Amir al-Mu'mineen, which we bear in our hearts, is supposed to push us towards action. Supposed to push us to walk in the steps of Amir al-Mu'mineen as much as we can. He's a poet, and he places this into perfect perspective. He went once to the haram of Amir al-Mu'mineen, Najaf al-Ashraf, and he writes a poem, he composes a poem. He says, I have blackened my face and darkened my heart with sins, but deep inside I have faith that Abu Turab will come to save me on the day of judgment. A person on whose hands and whose possession is Kawthar, will he be stingy towards me? A person who is known for karam and generosity, on a day when I'm in need, will he refuse me? A person who never said no to his enemy in the dunya, will he say no to his lover in the akhirah? Allahu Akbar. He wrote this poem and he recited it at the haram of Amir al-Mu'mineen. That night, the poet goes to sleep. He sees Amir al-Mu'mineen in his dream and he says to him, My Shafa will be there for you. But what you need to worry about is that how can I show my face to Ali when I claim to love Ali when I have darkened my face with such deeds? You have in the traditions that our a'mal are showed in front, are given to a ma'soom imam on a daily week. 12th imam is absolutely aware of everything that we've done in our lives. It's two angels that scribe our deeds, go to the ma'soom imam. The ma'soom imam looks and he knows what each and every person has done every week. And similarly on the day of judgment, Amir al-Mu'mineen, Qasim al-Nari wal-Jannah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given him this position. Fa'ani, I need to think and ask myself, a person who claims to love Ali, a person who longs to see Ali my whole life, how is it that I will stand in front of Ali and Ali sees the sins that I've committed? What face will I show him? What pushes a person towards amal? Love. This is the philosophy of these majalis. You have a mahfil and you speak about the fada'il of Amir al-Mu'mineen such that the hearts of the people become gravitated towards this great personality, and it is this love that will push them towards amal. And this is our hope. For Rasulullah picks up Amir al-Mu'mineen and he says, Qad aflaha al-Mu'minu. Rasulullah says to him, قَدْ أَفْلَهُ بِكَ. Ajib. In every day and age, there are those who have and bear enmity towards Amir al-Mu'mineen. They have worked their hardest and they have exerted utmost effort to try and erase any trace of Amir al-Mu'mineen from the books of history. They have come even as far as to deny the fact that Amir al-Mu'mineen was born inside the Kaaba. But alaykum bilhaq, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala never leaves this dunya without a hujjah, never leaves the people without an argument or a proof that is sufficient to guide them towards the right path. If there was not a single fadila from the fada'il of Amir al-Mu'mineen in any one of the books of the Shia or the Sunnah, this one incident in itself would be sufficient. Alaykum bil haq. Ever since Amir al-Mu'mineen was born in the Kaaba, along 1400 years, how many times has the Kaaba been destroyed and how many times has the Kaaba been reconstructed? Every time the Kaaba has been destroyed and reconstructed, the same crack where Fatima bint Asad reappears. Generation after generation has come and has tried to hide this miraculous event. Look, within the last 100 years, how many times has the Kaaba been reconstructed? How many times have they tried to hide the crack on the Kaaba to try and conceal the miraculous birth of Amir al-Mu'mineen? Because no other person before Ali was born in the Kaaba, no other person after Ali will be born in the Kaaba. So generation after generation, reconstruction after reconstruction, they try to plaster the Kaaba, cement the Kaaba, build the Kaaba with bricks, gold plate the Kaaba for all you want, hide the fact as much as you want, but the hand of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is there in every age and every generation. Even if the Kaaba was to be built of gold, that crack would appear over there to remind the people that there is only one wasi after Rasulullah, and that is Qaidul Gurr al-Muhajjalin, Imamul Muttaqin, Wasiyu Rasuli Rabbil Alameen, Ali ibn Abi Talib. Generation after generation, construct, reconstruct, destroy, rebuild that Kaaba, that crack will remain over there. This is Waliullah that you are talking about. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala willed. Not for anybody to confuse because of the tone and the environment that these are emotional statements that are made without any backing. Allah, the person with the most simplest frame of mind, the person, if you were to put people on an intellectual scale from 1 to 10, the person at the lowest level of the intellect, 1, will be able to tell you, just by the fact that Amirul Mu'mineen was born in the Kaaba, he deserves to be the Wasi and the Wali. Nobody else sharik with Amirul Mu'mineen. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala willed. This is not a coincidence. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala willed that Amirul Mu'mineen should be born in the house, which house, which will then be called Baytullah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala willed that the entire Muslim ummah, once in their lifetime, will come to perform Hajj and will do tawaf around the house where Ali was born. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decided it is not a coincidence. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decided that for the entire Muslim ummah, that if they want their spouses to be halal for them, then they should perform tawaf around the house where Ali ibn Abi Talib was born. It is not a coincidence that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala decided that 5 times a day, for every day until you are alive, you will perform salat in front of the house where Ali ibn Abi Talib was born. This is not a coincidence. This is to show the people that if you are looking for a Qibla, then that Qibla, from terms of your salat, is the Kaaba, but within that Qibla there is a greater Qibla. That Qibla is Ali ibn Abi Talib. If you have a problem with that Qibla, then you have a problem with that God who made him a Qibla. Find another God and find another Imam, and let us live in peace. Person with the simplest power of analysis, analytical power, put one and one and one together. All of these coincidences, law, ajeeb. Once in your life, Allah said, you must go and circumambulate around the house where Ali ibn Abi Talib was born. This is a lesson to show mankind. You cannot get closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bypassing Ali ibn Abi Talib. Abadan, abadan. Hujjah for all Muslims, regardless of their level of education, regardless of whether they're people from the villages or graduates of PhD, the fact that you go every year and you find that crack just never disappears, and the fact that you have to put your head wherever you are in the world down in front of the house where this person was born. And on top of that, Allah says that the house where Ali was born is Baytullah. What a great loss for those who abandoned Amirul Mu'mineen. What a great loss for those people who claim that Amirul Mu'mineen is their leader, but are enemies of Amirul Mu'mineen when it comes to their actions. How many people know the reality of Mawlud al-Kaaba? How many people know about the legacy that Amirul Mu'mineen left behind for us in terms of economics, in terms of politics, in terms of a healthcare system, in terms of aqaid, in terms of Arabic grammar? Each one of these are series of lectures on its own. Subhanallah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't leave the world without a hujjah. These signs of the superiority of Amirul Mu'mineen are not restricted for the Muslims. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has the best and the final argument. And with this, inshallah, I end the majlis. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave adequate signs to the entire mankind about the coming of Amirul Mu'mineen. Entire mankind at that time, whether they're Muslim or non-Muslim. Tradition states, after one of his battles, during the end of his life, Amirul Mu'mineen is returning back to Kufa, and he delivers a khutbah after Nahrawan. And I will give you part of this khutbah. He stands in front of the people and he says to him, Ayyuhannas, O people, none of you have an excuse tomorrow in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for rejecting my wilaya. None of you have an excuse in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for rejecting my waliya, my wilaya. Why? He says, Ana ismi fil injili iliya, wa fil tawrati bariya, wa fil zaburi iriya. He says, I am the one who's named in the Injil as Iliya. I am the one who was named in the Torah as Bariya. I am the one who was named in the Zabur as Iriya. And then he goes on further to say that every community across the globe has prophesied about my coming before the birth of Amir al-Mu'mineen. He says, every community has prophesied about my coming. He says, I am the one who was prophesied amongst the Indians as being Kabir. I am the one who was prophesied amongst the Romans as being Bitris. I am the one who was prophesied amongst the Persians as being Jubair. I am the one who was prophesied amongst the Ethiopians as being Bitrit. As for the Arabs who do not know me, then I am that person who went on the day of Khaybar and introduced myself to Marhab by saying, Ana alladhi samatni ummi Haydara.
Ya Ali.
Nobody has an excuse in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And what about that battle of Khaybar? Allahu Akbar. Our time is over. We pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala this majlis is counted as an ibadah. Dhikru Ali ibadah. Hubbu Ali ibadah. And inshallah, this love drives us towards acting and following in the footsteps of Amirul Mu'mineen. We pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Shias, lovers of Amirul Mu'mineen in every corner of the earth, wherever you are, wherever they are, Ya Allah, bihaqqi Amirul Mu'mineen, you grant them safety and aman in the dunya and in the akhirah. Ya Allah, grant us the honor of going to Najaf al-Ashraf to perform the ziyarah of Amirul Mu'mineen. Ya Allah, give us that power to walk in the footsteps of Amirul Mu'mineen, bihaqqi Amirul Mu'mineen. Ya Allah, brothers and sisters have come here from number of places with number of hajat, bihaqqi Amirul Mu'mineen. Ya Allah, do not let anybody leave this area, this Mubarak Husayniya, except that you have fulfilled their hajat, bihaqqi Amirul Mu'mineen. Ya Allah, brothers and sisters looking to get married, make for them their issue easier, bihaqqi Amirul Mu'mineen. Allah, those who are married and don't have children, bihaqqi Amirul Mu'mineen. Ya Allah, you make easy for them and grant them a progeny that is religious. Ya Allah, family members and friends who are not in the best of health, grant them shafa'a bihaqqi Amir al-Mu'mineen. Ya Allah, marhumin, marhumat, family members, friends who have passed away, grant them or make their graves into a garden from the gardens of Jannah bihaqqi Amir al-Mu'mineen. Allahumma ajjil li waliyyina al-faraj bihaqqi Amir al-Mu'mineen waj'alna min ansarihi wa ashya'ih birahmatika ya arhamar rahimin. Inna Allah wa malaikatahu yusalluna ala al-Nabi. Ya ayyuhal الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما